Okay, please go live.
So, good morning, all of you. It's a great pleasure for us to have the Secretary for Department of Biotechnology, Dr. Renu Swaroop, with us and going to speak on igniting minds, spurring innovations for all the summer research training program students of CSIR, which is numbering in several thousands. And I don't have to tell that how important it is to ignite the minds and spur innovations. And Department of Biotechnology is in the forefront of doing this. And there were several programs which were initiated by Dr. Swaroop, like BIRAC, and she was associated with the Department of Biotechnology, and they made pioneering contributions in this area. And in this series, for your benefit, ma'am, we have several people who has already given talks, like Dr. Mashelkar, Dr. Samir Brahmachari, and Dr. K.N. Vyas yesterday. And we are also going to have people like Dr. Ashutosh Sharma. The series started with our DGCSIR giving the initial talk. And we also have the consent from Mr. Narayan Murthy of Infosys, Dr. Ashutosh Sharma, and several people are in the pipeline, and we are extremely happy that the topmost Indian scientists as well as the policymakers are coming together and taking their time to interact with the people. And this will be a great boost for people who are spread from Kashmir to Kanyakumari and from Jorhat to Ahmedabad, north, east, west, and the students are really getting highly motivated by listening to these leaders. And this particular program is available in YouTube as well as Facebook, and it is live streaming. And usually we get around 1500 to 2000 people watching live, and several thousands of people will be able to see it after the program is over, because it is available as YouTube. And with this, I would like to really thank Dr. Renu Swaroop, who despite her very, very busy schedule, could spare her valuable time to interact with our students on behalf of CSIR and all the family of CSIR. We are very much thankful to you, ma'am. It's not only CSIR, it's the entire academic diaspora of the country. And Professor Alok Dhawan, who is really very keenly involved in promoting this, will be introducing you. And I request Professor Alok Dhawan to introduce Dr. Renu Swaroop.
Thank you, Shastri, and welcome, ma'am, to this program. I think we are already ignited, looking forward to your talk. For the benefit of the students, I must mention that Dr. Renu Swaroop, who is currently the Secretary to the Government of India Department of Biotechnology in the Ministry of Science and Technology, has been at the forefront of biotechnology for almost 30 years. I would say almost since inception of the department, she has been involved with it. I think apart from her work in the area of science and technology, especially in genetics and plant breeding, most of her life has been involved in the management of biotechnology, in ensuring that the biotechnology reaches the last mile, in ensuring that the innovations that are happening are getting captured and people are getting motivated and are getting enough in terms of an ecosystem to spread their wings. She was instrumental as a chairperson of the Biotechnology Industry Research Assistance Council, which is BIRAC, in spurring this sort of entrepreneurship and innovation through the 50 bionests that they have now across the country, plus so many other programs that they have now, right from students all the way up to big industries who can actually join in. She, As an organizer, I think she's exceptionally talented. The way she has been able to organize large programs, we saw the Global Bio that happened. Before that, we had the IISF in Lucknow, and we saw the the amount of influence that she has, not only on scientists, but on policymakers. She has also been adjudged as one of the, or recognized as one of the most influential women scientists of India in Biospectrum in 2012. I should say, in my interactions with her personally, I find in her that, you know, she has this ability to carry everyone along with her. And perhaps that is what distinguishes her as a science leader, as an eminent person of this country who has taken the biotechnology to the forefront and has ensured that the biotechnology will perhaps take the India to the Atmanirbhar Bharat. And we are very fortunate to have you, ma'am, with us, and look forward to a very igniting and very stimulating talk for the students. So I think now I request you, ma'am, to kindly deliver your talk.
Thank you very much, Alok, and thank you so much, Dr. Shastri, for this introduction. But I think more than anything else, I'm looking forward to this interaction with the students, with all of them, because I have to compliment CSIR for putting together this whole lecture series. There is nothing better than bringing all our future generation scientists together to be able to understand what the importance of science is and how they contribute to this very important field and the role they are going to play, and they are playing even right now in taking forward what our ambitions are for this country. So I have a few slides as a presentation, and I'll share my screen. I'll share my screen if it works. Otherwise, I'll just speak like that. I think it will. Just a second. Can you see my slides?
Yes, ma'am.
Just go back. Are they moving? Is it okay? Can you see them?
They're not moving, ma'am. If you just go full screen and then we can see perhaps the presentation mode.
Yeah, that's what we were just trying. Just a second, just taking a minute.
Sure, ma'am.
We'll just put this in order. Teams for next. नीचे जो आइकॉन है टीम्स वाला जो ठीक है प्रेजेंटेशन कर दो फुल स्क्रीन कर यस जस्ट मूव इट ओके इज इट मूविंग कुड यू सी द स्लाइड मूविंग नॉट इज यस सो देयर इज सम प्रॉब्लम It's moving. It may be a lag time for the movement.
Okay.
So wonderful. So thank you very much. As I said, it's very important to see how we can get the young minds ignited. Spurring innovations is something which is important for us because, as you all know, the Prime Minister has been putting this out in each of his talks to the young students, to the scientists, saying how important it is for us as a country to look at becoming a globally important innovation nation. As I said, it's these young minds which are really our future. It is these young minds which then are the ones who are going to carry forward this whole culture. And with this, I thought I'd start with the key messages that I have from Dr. Abdul Kalam, which I'm sure all of you are have been following, and his message to the students is something which I am particularly very sort of motivated with. So I always like to share them when I speak with the students. So is the slide on now, Alok? Can you see the slide?
Ma'am, I can see, but they're still not in the full screen mode. But I don't know if others can see it in the full screen mode.
Okay, it's for full screen for me here. Should I redo it or should I just carry on like this?
Yeah, the slide is not changing for us. So, Shastri, is it changing for you?
It is not changing here.
I'll undo it and go back again. Well,
yes, sir.
Niche wala icon. Yeah, so I will just stop sharing and now share. और उसमें कितने गए पर उसको क्यों बंद हो गया not still moving hello
or
I think Alok it's not moving still
yeah
it is moving madam
it's moving now okay fine so I wanted to share these quotes from Dr. Abdul Kalam in which he very clearly gave this message to the young students that my message especially to the young people is to have courage to think differently courage to invent courage to travel the unexplored paths courage to discover the impossible and most importantly to conquer the problem and succeed and if you see his other message is very very clear that what is it that students need to do they need to ask questions they need to have an inquisitive mind and thinking is key and critical for them I think all these are very key and important things when we look at science and technology now what is science and technology science and technology is a very effective tool which connects ecosystems connects nations and connects the society now when we look at this I think the key message that is important for all the students to keep here is when you are doing science and technology when you are part of the science and technology ecosystem you are not disconnected with anything that you are doing the science that you are doing has to be connected and this connection of science has to be with the ecosystems with the nation with the society now coming to this forward how do we actually move ahead what is key and critical for us what is key for us is what are the key principles which students have to keep in mind the key principles are teamwork hard work focused and targeted outcomes and I think that is important unless and until the students keep that in mind it's not going to be easy for them to move ahead in their science as they take it forward now when we look at S&T policies what is it that we are looking from the S&T policy view how has the government of India looked at science and technology policy right from 1958 we had the first scientific policy resolution till we came to the 2013 science and technology policy each one of them enunciated a very clear path for us as to what is it the science has to do to contribute to society contribute to international collaborations contribute to innovation contribute in terms of looking at how this whole technology can be one of our biggest enablers to help India help the country to move forward as a knowledge economy as I said the three key pillars on which we focus all our scientific efforts is science technology and innovation these three key pillars are crucial and critical for us to move forward any of our activities that we are taking India has played a very very important role in international collaborations when we look at what we have done with many countries both in terms of multilateral cooperations in terms of bilateral cooperations in terms of national partnerships India is today recognized as a key leader in science a key leader in innovation and now key leader in translation as we have moved all these years there has been a very major shift we are no longer just receivers of technology when we look at global cooperations we have become co-developers of technology we have become partners equal partners in whatever we take forward so our whole focus has to be from idea to innovation to translation unless and until you translate your idea and take it to society take it to the users you are not going to be able to take the benefits of science to the end user that is why it's important that this whole cycle gets completed from idea to innovation to translation now how do we do this and this is really what the government of India is now looking at. If you see how we've moved in all these years of our science progress, the whole, you sort of map the trajectory, you'll see we started by doing individual investigator-driven research. We then moved to making it multi-investigator, so that you have more than one PI. We then made it multi-institution. We then made it multi-agency. And then bilateral, multilateral cooperations. But if you look at the circle on the left-hand side, you see that when we look at knowledge being translated, the circle becomes complete. If you have the academia, you have the research institutes, you have the industry, and you have the startups in the center of this to be able to connect the research which moves from the academia research institutes to the industry. And if we have to create these knowledge-driven technology enterprises, how do we do that? These have to be done through technology scale-up clusters. And this is really what the government is putting a lot of focus on. Most of the DBT, CSIR, and many other institutes of MHRD, institutes of eminence like the Indian Institute of Science, the IITs, the ICERs, they're all working in this model now, where we connect with startups, we connect with academic groups, we connect with industry. Why is that so important? Why is that so important for us to take innovation ahead? That's important because, first of all, science, research, technology, innovation, these are all multidisciplinary areas now. You cannot have just one discipline taking it forward. It has to be basically in terms of how do we take groups together who can bring in the strength of one group, leverage that strength, bring in, they're all interdisciplinary fields. And again, you need different levels of competence to be able to plot it. You need the biologists, you need the structural biologists, you need the computational biologists, you need the clinical scientists, you need the electrical engineers, the mechanical engineers, you need all of them. So once we connect, these clusters are very important and key. And these clusters are the ones which then actually help us move forward. If we have to take technology ahead, you need to scale up this technology, for which the government is now setting up what we call technology propellers. These propellers are where you look at co-development and co-location of industry within academic laboratories. You look at shared intellectual property. You look at technology licensing. You look at scientists moving. These are new models. These are models which have worked very well globally, but that's what we are looking at now. So these are opportunities which many of our young scientists have now to be able to interact. Now, science is very, very important if you look at what science is for diplomacy. If we can build all this, our international cooperations are very important because science plays a very important role. Once India becomes, and we are already on that path of being in the top few, we are already recognized, but we also play a very important role in connecting nations. So you see, I spoke about connecting ecosystems, I spoke about connecting nations, and then we spoke about connecting society. So connecting ecosystems is where I mentioned about connecting the industry, the academia, the research institutes. Now let's talk about connecting nations. How do you connect the nations? The nations are connected through our science diplomacy programs, whether they are scientific cooperations, whether this is diplomacy for science or science in diplomacy. When you look at how science guides your foreign policy, how do you build very strong tools on this? And this really is the strength which India has in terms of its international S&T engagements across the globe. More than 80 countries we've collaborated with. That's how science is binding countries together. That's how science, it's weaving a common thread of common challenges, a common thread of objectives that we collectively can then respond to. How do we collaborate globally? We do research partnerships for global and national challenges. We bring in researcher mobility. There are a lot of such schemes across the government departments, DBT, DST, CSIR, ICMR, MHRD, atomic energy, all of them, where they allow researchers to move within projects, other than projects. There are training and capacity building exercises where we look at new technologies, where we see how we could look at bringing in, adapting newer emerging technologies, how India could move into the next stage of technology development. Our models of science collaboration, as I said, could be bilateral or multilateral. They could be area specific, whether it's healthcare, whether it's energy, whether it's agriculture. We've also had some excellent institutional collaborations with different institutions. And these are just examples that I'm naming here as we move on. Coming now very clearly to see what role does innovation play if we to connect with society. And here I quote our Honorable Prime Minister when he said, "I see startups, technology and innovation as exciting and effective instruments for India's transformation." The statement the Honorable Prime Minister made when he had announced the Startup India Action Plan in 2016. And this has been key and instrumental for us to move forward as we look at how the biotech sector is moving ahead. Now, coming specifically to the biotechnology sector, which I take as an example to run you through how science and technology contributes to society. If you look at this whole sector, and if you see these logos that I've put around it, right from Poshan Abhiyan to Ayushman Bharat to our Jal Shakti Abhiyan to Startup India to Digital India, Swachh Bharat, each one of them, we contribute to each of these activities. There are a large number of startups who have come in. There are a large number of incubators. So this program that we now have been able to set up to see how biotechnology, which is currently at about $63 to $65 billion, how can we double that in the next 4 to 5 years? How can we take it to about between 130 to 150 billion. This is going to be through all the three components that we're talking about. Building the ecosystem, national and international partnerships, and seeing that what we do connects to the society. The growing ecosystem in India. Yes, the government has played a very, very major role in this growing ecosystem. Today, we had actually, when the Honorable Prime Minister announced this in 2016, said that we will have about 2,000 startups by 2020. Today, as we stand, it's nearly 3,500. We've gone much past our target. Now, how have we done that? We basically tried to look at different enabling ecosystems, enabling policies. And the reason I'm sharing this with all of you is many of the young students today, when they come into their research, when they are moving into their career, they're looking at different options where they can contribute. So one clear option is the basic research, the key fundamental research from where we have the idea generation, the knowledge generation. The other area is being able to look at translational research, where you connect with all the clinical groups, the in the agriculture sector with the plant breeders and many others. And the third is the entrepreneurial career path that you choose for yourself. And I think each of them, if you look, go remember the first slide I showed you from idea to innovation to translation, each one of them is very important. Each of the blocks is important. And we need very competent scientists and researchers to contribute to each of those blocks as we move on. We've created very, very strong innovation hubs, and this is BIRAC's network, which we have set up. This is the fertile soil which is before you now to come and sow into this some excellent seeds, which you will be, as a country, will be able to then reap the wonderful fruits of. This is truly a fertile soil, which we are nourishing with a lot of inputs. But we are confident that as we move on, this is going to give us a lot of excellent results, right from financing to networking to handholding to connecting them to mentor networks, helping in IP, helping in technology transfer. Each of these activities is looked at. Where really are these startups coming from right now? Certain pockets in the country. My only message to everybody here is the country will flourish, the country will reach the point in which we want it to be in the top three nations globally when we see these bubbles across the country, pan-India, bubbles of a large size pan-India. And each of you has to contribute to that, because as I was informed, there are a large number of students who are with us today, many others watching on YouTube. Each one of you has to then recognize and say, how can I play a role? Not just in startups. This ecosystem has to be built across the country. As I said, some may be researchers with deep knowledge generation, some may be engaged in the translational aspects, and some may be part of the startup ecosystem. Collectively, remember the slide I showed you of the whole circle of academia, research institutes, startups, and industry. Those circles are the ones which are going to help us, and we would like to see these circles spread across the country. It's only then that this country would be able to succeed. Across sectors, biotechnology has got its footprints all over, agriculture, healthcare, clean energy, medtech, biopharma, each of the sectors we contribute, and we've actually contributed a lot into this. We have a large number of incubatees, a large number of startups that we've been able to bring into this vibrant ecosystem. You see the numbers here. More than 5,000, we've got more than 10,000 people who are engaged with the regional clusters. We're looking at outreach events. We're looking at Sitare and E-Yuva. These are our young student schemes. Looking at innovations of student innovations is Sitare. E-Yuva is our young innovators through the university sector. So it's the young Sitare, the E-Yuva, taking them to the big ignition grants. The whole ecosystem, which is so well connected to our IMS, and this really is the impact that we've seen. We've had a lot of startups now bringing their solutions into the market. So you see how science has so well got connected, not just to building ecosystems and nations, but also connected with the society. Today, these are the large number of products which are in the market. And I must say, at this particular time of crisis of the COVID, our startups, our researchers, our scientists have all stood up. They've all come together with the key principles that I shared with you in the first slide. And that is teamwork, hard work, staying very focused. With that, India today is leading from the front to fight this whole COVID-19 pandemic. And each one of them has played an important role. This quote by Steve Jobs, it says, innovation distinguishes between a leader and a follower. Now it's for each of you to decide what you want to be. Do you want to be a follower or you want to be a leader? I'm sure your answer, if you were sitting in front of me in a room, I would have got you to answer. But since I can only see a screen, I'm sure each one of you is saying leader. To be a leader, what do we have to do? We to innovate. And this really is going to be key for you to take it forward. But you see with these innovations which have happened in these last 4 or 5 years, there has been a tremendous impact. This is really, some of this data is still needs to be updated a couple of months back. But you see these numbers which you see in the lower bottom part of the slide tells you the value that has been created with these startups. These are all young researchers, and many times when I say young researchers, I also must admit that our ignition grant, which is for young researchers, are not just young by age, they're young in their mind, because we have some ignition grantees who are on the other side of 50 as well, some of them moving into 60 and moving into becoming senior citizens, as we are called in various other words. But that's really what it's being young at heart to be able to see how your innovation moves. But students and researchers play a very important and key role in this. We've got, as I said, financing schemes where the government now has become a partner in terms of venture capital funding, through seed fund, through leap fund, through various other options. A couple of success stories to let you know how young students, a group of graduates from the Indian Institute of Science, they today are working on the human liver tissue models. They were supported by our ignition grant. Today, you see this young team. In 2017, I got this picture from them. But if you see, they were funded by Flipkart. I don't have a recent picture. I'm sure they have some more faces which have joined them, and I know many of them have not left, so it's still a very strong team. Similarly, we have this team, which is again from IIT Madras. They were supported by our Ignition grant. They've received a lot of investment funding. I can go on and on. We have nearly about 40 to 50 such success stories. But what I thought was best to do was to put happy faces onto one slide and show you how happy each one of them are. Is they've all come out from IITs, from IISCs, from research institutes, some from our own institutes, from ICGB, from NCL, many of the CSIR and DBT labs, set up their own enterprises, got teams together, and then been able to succeed with products which we've taken to the society. The last two slides I would share with you is one question which is in all our minds is, what are we heading towards? In normal circumstances, would we have really sat like this with me sitting in my office and all of you all sitting in your own seats and listening to each other? But then, that's our new normal. Physical distancing, lockdowns, restricted mobility. But do we take that as a problem or do we take that as an opportunity? I think let's look at it as an opportunity. The opportunity is you get virtually connected. You can connect with many, many people. If I ask Dr. Alok Dhawan and Dr. Shastri, if they had to put together a hall full of 1,500 people from all over the country, they would have spent a year in the logistics getting them together. Virtual connectivity, we've connected with thousands and thousands of people. That helps us to enhance our collaborations. That helps us to bring in global cooperations. Today, when we talk about COVID solutions, we're talking about global cooperations. Whether it is our diagnostic development, whether it's our vaccine development, whether it's our therapeutics. This is really what our Prime Minister has for us. Make in India, Startup India, and Atmanirbhar Bharat. COVID has surely shown us the way of an Atmanirbhar Bharat. Whether it is our diagnostic kits that we've developed for COVID testing, whether it is the Ayush products which are now being looked at as to how we could have our own from the therapeutics also, looking at our own APIs that we can develop, looking at the reagents and the components, and we're all now looking at our own indigenous vaccine that will be developed, but more importantly, creating an ecosystem for it. This gives us an opportunity for global excellence. We know that the target that we've set for India to be in the top 5 countries by 2025, it's not something we cannot achieve. But then each of you has to contribute. Each of you is to contribute to see how do we look at this universe as our target? How do we have to see what is it that we have to contribute to be able to achieve that target? And as I said, I started by saying science, technology, and innovation are three key pillars. I will conclude with the same slide. These are three key pillars on which we can build a very strong global foundation. We can connect people, we can connect society, and we can connect nations. What do we connect them for to meet the global challenges? Each of you must have that passion in you. Each one of you must have that vision in you. Each one of you must have that dedication in you and that commitment which says, I can do it. Whatever you contribute to is going to be important. Many a times we go and think that, what am I doing? It's only a small drop in the ocean. But you have to remember, it's those small drops which make that ocean. Unless and until you put in your best, unless and until you follow that focused pathway, you will not be able to achieve what really is our ultimate mission. And we know that science knows no boundaries, it recognizes no borders. We all have to work towards taking science to achieve our common goal of a healthy world, but most importantly, a sustainable universe. So, thank you very much. Thank you very much. I hope with this message that you have got, you will be able to not only look at trying to see how we will be able to connect, how would we be able to work with different groups, how will we be able to work with different groups, how will we be able to right side, and how will you as a nation be able to contribute to what the whole science growth of this country is in terms of being able to contribute. I congratulate CSIR once again, and I hope that each of you students is going to be a future leader for us as we move through. Thank you very, very much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Excellent talk. I think all the students as well as all of us are very excited to listen to your views about how we take India forward. There will be some questions, ma'am, on this live chat. So I'll request Dr. Shastri to take some of these questions. You're muted, Shastri.
Really, it's a very exciting thing. And you really ignited several minds, and they will try to take innovation. And as in the last few weeks, we are having a few young students who are collating all the lectures. And then they are asking the question answers. With your permission, I will ask Lisa Muni and Monty to go ahead with the question answer session. Okay. So I request Lisa and Monty.
Ma'am, can you stop sharing the slides now?
Yes, please. Is that okay now?
Yeah, perfect.
Yeah. Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, it was a great honor for us to listen to you. It was a very informative and nice lecture. And there are many appreciation for the lecture. And there are lots of questions also. So with your permission, I'd like to ask you a few questions.
Sure.
So ma'am, the first question is from Abru Hafiz. He's asking, what is the first step to innovation after the formation of an idea?
Okay, that's a very interesting question. So when the idea comes in, I think innovation, first of all, doesn't have a stepwise growth as you look at it. It's not a science experiment that you can plan and say, this is my first step of innovation and that's my first step of innovation. Any idea that you have to take to move it ahead, it's very important for you to say, what's going to be new in this idea that I'm going to take for? How is it going to be different? What's the value addition that I'm going to put into it? Is there going to be a new component that I'm going to add? Once you look at it, that's when it encourages you to go onto the path of innovation. You also have to remember one thing, that when you get onto the path of innovation, there's a lot of risk involved in it. There is no, like science, there is no 100% success in what you do. You may want to go onto a path and then you feel that, well, this is not working. Because you also have to remember one thing, innovation is key, but what is your goal that you're looking at the innovation, how do you translate it and take it to society or take it to the end user or take it to the market? So everything has to be an innovation which can be translated. So this is not a very straight line process that you can put a step 1, 2, and 3 to it. You may have to keep going back to the drawing board and bringing in new components to it. But again, I'll go to the slide which I said to you, you must be very focused. Your target must be very focused. You must know what you have to achieve. If you know what you have to achieve, you know what is new that you have to bring into it, automatically your path will move forward. Okay.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Our next question is from Abru Hafiz. Yes. What is the first step to innovation after the formation of an idea? Sorry. Next question is from Aruna. Do you think government should encourage women in science and technology by initiating more funding or training schemes for women in science?
Absolutely. My answer is why not? I mean, that's really what we are wanting to do. First of all, let me tell you, women scientists are as important. It's a gender diversity that we talk about. So there's no reason why women scientists are not playing an important role. Women scientists play an equally important role, and we need to ensure a gender balance as we move forward. But yes, we do recognize that there are certain issues which women scientists face as they move in their career. There are career breaks. There are movement issues where they need to move to different locations because of their family issues. How do we resolve that? How do they come back after a career break? So the government of India has a large number of schemes. My own department has the BioCare scheme. DST has the Women in Science scheme. CSIR has special incentives for women scientists. We then have not only R&D grant schemes, we have awards, we have recognizing excellence. We have special training and capacity building programs, which are for women scientists, which we do nationally and internationally. I would only like to say one thing to all the young women scientists here. Do not think that because these schemes are being put out as separate schemes for you, we are compromising on quality anywhere. You are at par with the science which is being done in the country. It's just that because you were not in the mainstream, there were unemployed women scientists who had to be brought back. A separate stream was introduced for it, but no quality compromise. So whatever research you do, whatever research is published by our women scientists from these special schemes is at par with all the other research that gets published. We have excellent publications, we have excellent patents, excellent technology development happening. And you look at the startup ecosystem now. In fact, we started with just about 4% women, and now I don't have the latest statistic, but anyway, it's going to be about 20%. I know 20 to 25% must be women startups. Could be much more also, I'm not very sure. So definitely there's a complete focus of the government, many schemes, and we would look forward to supporting many more. Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. So the next question is from Bablin Kaur. She is asking for some suggestions on to how we reduce unemployment in the field of science if a person doesn't want to take risk in startups.
Okay. So you already got the other option of
ma'am, should I repeat the question?
No, no, I've got the question. You said if startups, you don't want to take a risk of startups and yet you want to reduce the unemployment. So I think while there are a lot of employment opportunities in research institutes, in other fields, startups is one of them. It's not that startup is the only, but there are other science-related careers which many women, many scientists, not just for women, I'm saying this for general take on. I explained to you how now knowledge-driven clusters are moving into technology clusters and moving into manufacturing zones. So you have the whole field of IP management. You have the whole field of technology transfer. You have a very important field which many science students and researchers don't think of, and that's science communication. Today, a lot of our science cannot reach people because we don't communicate it well. Science extension workers. Many times we leave the extension activities of societal programs to just extension workers who may not have a science background. People with a science background taking science and technology to the society is a much better connect. We've started many of our societal technology cluster programs. We've started our Biotech Kisan program, where we see how scientists take on the role of being science extension workers, and it works so beautifully. So don't look at just very stereotyped, you know, straightforward employment opportunities. Yes, those are very important. We need to have researchers, we need postdoctoral fellows, we need faculty, we need the technical people who are going to handle a lot of the data analytics, we need computational biologists, we need a whole stream of those. But in addition to that, we also need these people who are into these areas which facilitate the translation of science across countries, across nations to the society. So I think those are very, very important roles also which can be looked at.
Ma'am, we have the next question from our institute itself. It's from Dr. Romy. He would like to ask whether DBT Nanomission has any plan on nanoparticle mediated drug delivery project beside the NanoAgri projects.
Oh, I thought there were so many of them. Alok, you should have been answering this question and not me. Dr. Alok Dhawan will give you a whole lot of nano and pharma projects. We brought out a nano pharma guideline very recently, and the nano agri guideline has only come out now, which is fresh in the students' mind. You've forgotten the nano pharma guideline that we brought out in October, November last year. So nano pharma is key actually. What we are doing with the nano agri is now encouraging people that also get into the agri sector. The key delivery system, the key drug nano pharma sector is huge. And there is a lot of impetus we lay on it. And there are a lot of research groups. In fact, many of these have actually gone into translation mode. And many of them are now, the industries and startups are working on it. So nano sector as a whole has a lot of potential, whether it's nano pharma or nano ag. Both of them have. The whole area of nano has a lot of potential.
Ma'am, the next question is, will it be possible to set up an in vitro germplasm conservation center at CSIR NIST as a hub of Northeastern biodiversity?
I thought that CSIR NIST was already well established. You should ask your DG that. But I can only say that DBT has been a wonderful partner with CSIR. And if there is any such proposal of the Northeast CSIR center, I'm sure the DBT groups will look at it very, very favorably. And DBT and CSIR have been partnering in a lot of in vitro germplasm centers, and Northeast is our special focus for the biodiversity. DBT has a major program in Northeast. I'm sure we must be having our presence in East as well. Not definitely. Northeast needs to be promoted to conserve the biodiversity, which is a treasure of our nation.
I think, ma'am, the students are looking for the future.
Absolutely, absolutely. Good to see them excited with this. But DBT and CSIR have always partnered, and we'll be very happy to partner with anything like this.
Ma'am, the next question is there any plan for DBT Overseas program in coming years?
DBT Overseas program, yes. We had stopped for a short while the CREST fellowships for various reasons. Northeast, we were still continuing. We were doing special programs for Northeast, but we had different opportunities. We had not put it out as a DBT Overseas CREST fellowships for that was in between for 2-3 years for various reasons. There are financial constraints, there are other constraints, but having said that, the bilateral cooperation overseas fellowships were still continuing with UK, with Australia, with Germany, with US. We had a large number of fellowships which were continuing. Once COVID goes and travels can open, I'm sure travel programs will begin again. But fellowships are always a high priority for us, training and capacity.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. The next question is, there is a huge resource of biotechnology researchers present in the country. What are the visions and plans for full utilization of biotechnologists in the coming years?
I gave you this whole vision and plan just now. It's for 30 minutes I spoke with you telling you what the vision of the country is. We can't achieve that without you people. Each one of you has to now, after this talk, relate yourself with each of the components I've spoken about. See, you must be having your own choices. Some may be more inclined towards the healthcare sector, some towards the agri sector, some towards the industrial, across the sectors. Again, each one of you has your own area of interest, whether it's to the basic sciences, fundamental sciences, deep knowledge generation, blue sky research, getting into the translational ecosystem, trying to connect interdisciplinary areas, looking at the startup ecosystem, as I said, taking it to society. So you have to find a connect for yourself. We have a large vision for this country. We feel that this country is very well positioned to be able to be a top leader. Biotech, sunrise sector. There's no reason why biotech is not going to prosper in the next 2 to 3 years, much beyond for what it has done in the last few years as well. And we cannot do that without your participation. So we have ambitious plans for you. And I'm confident that you people are going to come forward and contribute to these ambitions that we have for you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. The next question is from Dr. Romy. Crowdsourcing is a proven approach for connecting and involving the people in the growth and translation of science and technology. What is your comment on crowdsourcing from the Indian context, and how DBT can contribute on building a crowdfunding ecosystem in India?
So, crowdsourcing is important if you're looking at ideas scaled up, you're looking at startups being scaled up, you're looking at enterprises being scaled up. The advantage which crowdsourcing has is that you are being able to convince multiple groups that your idea makes sense. And that, I think, is again a strength of your idea. The government is already playing a key role. the government is playing a key role. As I said, BIRAC has VC funds. Now we have our seed fund, we have our LEAP fund, we have our ACE fund. So government generally is a little risk averse into getting into VC funds, but the fact that we put our funds forward, these are being operated through VC operators, through incubators, to be able to take this ahead. Now, they are the ones who connected on crowdsourcing, crowdfunding platforms. And many of them are doing it. You see Venture Center, which is the CSIR center at Pune, they have excellent crowdfunding and crowdsourcing coming in for many of their enterprises. IKP Hyderabad, you have CCAMP at Bangalore, KIT at Bhubaneswar. Now, even the IITs have started working towards it, Mumbai, Kanpur. So, I think it's now what happens is the government fund becomes a catalyst. The moment you put in your government fund, they know that the government is ready to put in and take a risk on this particular enterprise. That automatically you're mitigating part of the risk by becoming a partner to it. And then it's open. Other partners are obviously taking it forward. So yeah, sure, that's something which is moving in many, many areas. Mainly towards the IT enabled, etc. Because many venture groups feel a little confident because it's got a shorter gestation period. It delivers faster. So it doesn't have the detailed complexities of a regulatory ecosystem, but I'm sure the others are also coming in. I mentioned to you about the human liver model that was made. That is getting into a lot of VC funding and even crowdfunding that they're looking at. So you see, people are even looking at complex models like that now. So there is a lot of potential and opportunity.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Our young people have a lot more questions. It is ranging from space microbiology to the research funding policies to several very intricate questions about the startups. And actually, you have given a broad overview of many, many aspects with which we can go ahead and get the answers for these questions. And we will also be taking some of these questions offline. And we have our colleague, Dr. Ranjana Agarwal, who is the director of NISTATS and NISCASE. And I would like Dr. Ranjana to make her comments before we take some comments from others and then a final vote of thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Shastri. I really wish I could have spent more time taking questions from the students. It's so wonderful to interact with them. I hope we can overcome this COVID crisis and meet physically. If we do that, I promise I will add some. But as I said, it's going to be a logistic nightmare for you to bring in 1,500 students. Maybe the virtual platform is much better. So at any time, I'll be very, very happy to offline to take the questions from them. And
ma'am, thank you very much. And we may request one more session from you just for the interaction.
No question answers, no talk from me. Okay, we could think about it. We'll be able to think about it. Yeah, let's work it out. Maybe we could do that.
Yeah, actually, Dr. Narayan Murthy also has said that he will speak only for 5 minutes and he will be taking only question answers for 40 minutes.
I'll be happy to do that and maybe think it over. Maybe when, you know, in the next few days, we could plan a question answer session.
Thank you, ma'am.
What you can do is, I will send you my presentation. You can share the presentation with the students. So if there are some new students coming in, they also get the presentation. Then I don't have to speak and we can just take a question answer.
Thank you very much, ma'am. That will be great because we have a slight technical snag that the slides are shaking a little bit in the YouTube. And that will be great. We will be sharing your...
I'll send it to you.
Yeah, thank you. Dr. Ranjana?
Thank you, Dr. Shastri. Namaskar, Dr. Swaroop. It is such a pleasure to see you again. I am remembering India International Science Festival 2018 when you were, chairing the Women Scientist Conclave. You know, I am very happy to see you here addressing the young scientists, technocrats, with such a big optimism. For me, it's all the more happier moment when I can see you presenting the things in such a holistic, comprehensive perspective, because this is the time when, during the lockdown and all these restrictive conditions, students sitting at home are not feeling very optimistic. They feel like frustrated and all those things. But you turn the table. And being women, I would like to compliment this. As one of the young students also asked the question about the women scientists. But I also believe we also need more women leaders as scientists like you. Because when we, it is the gender stereotyping that from the, primary school onward, it is told to the girls, like science is not their forte, they cannot do good. But when they see people like you leading the science of the country from the front, they get so motivated. I'm really, really very happy that you are there. And you talked about the BioCare scheme. And now, because we are going into the STIP 2020, the science, national policy for science, technology, innovation. So I think these kind of schemes, the BioCare, you said, in DBT, and the women in science in DST, girls are also being roped in into the system. I think the whole ecosystem the country is going to see in the coming decade, it's going to be totally, totally changed. And when the people like you are there to support the whole STI, I was so impressed to see your, first slide and the last slide. You didn't deviate at all. You were like, these are the three pillars for strong global foundation for society. So I really thank you very much for giving such a wonderful talk. My just one concern I would like to, it's like my own opinion. You showed one picture where there were bubbles, where the startups are going on. And you said that, like you want to see more bubbles pan India, not only in the limited metro cities or the places where already these kind of activities are going on. Because in this summer research training program, we are having students all across India from the, state universities, even from the colleges. So I think if you can say something about these startups for the smaller places and the institutions which are not of the national eminence or not IITs, IISCs only, can we have some kind of, supporting words for the students who are coming from towns, small cities? So what kind of future do you see for them in the coming years? Thank you.
Thank you, Ranjana. Important point you raised. There are a lot of such schemes where we're looking at students through our Sitare program, through our EUPA program, through the Srishti and Gaiti Awards. So we can send you more details of that. And what I will do is I will get somebody to send you the brochures of that. You can probably circulate it to all your students because that will be an information material as well. But there are a lot of opportunities. But yes, we would love to scale that up, definitely.
Thank you very much. Dr. Alok, you would like to say?
No, I think I'm good. I think after what Dr. Swaroop has mentioned, there's no point beating out the bush. She was very direct and she very candidly mentioned about this. Just a very, I think, fantastic talk.
Yeah. So before I can ask Dr. Anjana to formally say a vote of thanks, I have several questions are there. I would like to summarize that. What may be the most important attribute for the outcome of a research funding? Publications or patents or technology? How do we measure these things?
So, Dr. Shastri, if you want an answer for me right away, I would say each one of them has got an importance in their own way. As I said, right from basic sciences to translational sciences to societal connect, each one of them, each has a different metrics for measurement of success and parameters. So you cannot put one over the other. Each one has to be measured for its own different success, for its own different field for which it is being taken on. But it's important for you to recognize what is it that you want to do. What is it that And many times this whole area from idea to translation to society connect is like a relay race. One completes a particular thing and hands over the baton to the next player to take it forward. So it's a continuous flow. You can't work disjointed or in, you know, parallel streams which are never going to meet. So they have to meet at some point of time. And that, therefore, it's important that you put in different evaluation matrices as you take.
Thank you very much, ma'am. This is really very, very important for students to realize that whatever is the area, whether it is a basic science or an applied science or a translational science or startup, the key is to excel in whatever that you are doing. And most importantly, to have this positive infection that we have to have in the tough times. And when something like COVID struck, we would try to see that the best in us will come out. And when the going is tough, when the going gets tough, the tough gets going. And we are all very, very proud that our leadership is really strong in India, right from our Honorable Prime Minister to the secretaries of different departments. And Department of Biotechnology is doing a great job. And then all of you should be lucky to have such an ambience in our country. And I hope that under the collective leadership of our leaders, our science will continue to make a strong impact on the society and also will be excelling in basic as well as applied sciences. With this, I would like to request Dr. Anjana to give the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Shastri, for giving me this opportunity to formally propose a vote of thanks. Dear Dr. Renu Swarup, Secretary, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Science and Technology, Government of India, also Chairperson, Biotechnology Industry Research Associate Council, I would like to thank you on my own behalf and on behalf of CSIR whole family and NIST particularly for accepting our invitation to deliver a talk on Igniting Minds, Spurring Innovation in Summer Research Training Program, SRTP 2020. It is indeed a moment of pride for us that our young students, internees, got the chance to listen from you directly what's going on in the country at the moment, because I think this is the time when science and technology is being talked in the society, you know, in day-to-day basis. Otherwise, science and technology always gets some kind of, you know, secondary place in the media. But this is the time when society is looking at science and the scientists. And people like you, Dr. Shastri, truly mentioned that the leadership is so dynamic, so, you know, sensitive towards society need that you are addressing the things very sensitively. And you rightly said that innovation is not, you know, A, B, C step. Innovation is something when you are sensitive towards societal need, when you look something wrong going into the environment, and then you become sensitive, start thinking about it from the heart. And that's the time when your mind is ignited. And when your mind is ignited, it works multifold, thinks out of the box and comes out with a solution. And these solutions are innovations. And DBT, by the BIREC, the organization which works at the interface of industry and academia, truly empowers innovative and emerging technologies, startups. You have generated such a high hope and optimism in the students by telling so many positive things like how they can be supported by the government schemes. You talked about the success stories. I think it is very important to connect the you know, young generation. One of the students asked the question that they don't want to go for the startup, but what are the other unemployment, what are the other features to handle unemployment? But when you talk about success stories, it gives them the good feel factor, and that encourages them to go for it. And the schemes you talked about, UA, EUA, incubators, young incubators, Sitare, I think everything you said was so apt and so much connecting the youth with the science and technology. So the kind of, you know, disinterest we are seeing in the young generation at the moment towards science and technology, people like you, when they talk, when they express their views, I think they will be highly, highly motivated. And I would like to thank Dr. Shastri also for creating a platform where he is bringing the brightest of the minds of the country, scientists, technocrats who have achieved success in their profession, and bringing them as role models to the young students. I'm sure this SRTP program will be highly successful. I would also like to thank Dr. Alok Dhawan for his motivating words every time. All the participants, scientists, and the internees who are attending this lecture. Once again, I would like to say my special thanks to Dr. Renu Swarup for addressing us and presenting her views. And we look forward to listen more from you. As you must be knowing, nobody is, still satisfied. They want to have more questions, more interactive session. So we'll see you again. Thank you so very much for joining us. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. And our students have, thank you very much, ma'am. Our students have made just a few points based on the talk that you have made, and we are flashing it for you to.
Excellent. I'll send you my slides also so that you have them with you.
Right. Thank you. It's very exciting, and thank you very much. Thank you very much, Alok and Anjana.
Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.